Good evening. My name is Diane Walker, and I wanted to thank everyone for coming out this evening to it's the beginning, but it's in the middle of our Black History Month celebration. I want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to come hear this wonderful, amazing woman, Angeline Butler. I wanted to let you know today that Ms. Butler is an actress, singer, educator, Freedom Flame Award recipient. Tonight, in a one-woman presentation on the student involvement nonviolent movement with special guest co-singer activist Ross Alton. Thank you so much.
Thank you and welcome, everybody.
In Ms. Butler's performance career, she was featured in over 146 television appearances. She has performed theatrically with the Milwaukee Repertory, Joseph Papp's New York Public Theater. Her credits are too numerous for us to mention here completely. She is currently on the faculty of John Jay College for Criminal Justice in New York. Her oral history on civil rights and her autobiographical scrapbook, Angeline Butler, are on exhibit in the Nashville Room at the National Public Library and are available online through the Civil Rights Digital Library. And also,
this book, Hands on the Freedom Flag, was runner up to the book by Michelle Alexander, The New Jim Crow, for the NAACP Award last year. This is the account of about 50 women in the SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. I just wanted to bring your attention to the book. I've had the great good fortune and pleasure to meet Ms. Butler last year in Santa Monica when we were on the panel together. And I have seen a sample of her work. She's spellbound. She brings to life the civil rights movement. And I remember as a young man in working and living in San Francisco, coming in every evening and watching on the national news the struggles of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and SCLC, Southern Christian Leadership Conference in the South, and wondering how I could get involved and how I could help. Well, as it turned out, I didn't have to go south. The Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee came to me to San Francisco, so I got involved. But these are my heroes: Angeline Butler, Ms. Fannie Lou Hamer, all the members of the SNCC, Southern Christian Leadership Conference, the demonstrators. These were all my heroes, and people that I looked up to, and people that I wanted to emulate and to work with. So without further ado, we're just going to Ms. Butler speak for herself. I'd like to introduce Angeline Butler.
Hi. So nice to be here to La Pintoresca Branch of Public Library. This is Mr. Ross Hoffman, and you may not know him, but I want you to know I wrote a play about the civil rights movement about 25 years ago, and the Honorable Septima points that Clark spoke after it each night at the church in Ocean Park in Santa Monica. And I don't know if you know who Septima Poinsett Clark is, but she's the person that trained Rosa Parks, and that's why she kept her seat on the bus. And so Ross Ortman played Guy Caroline for me at that time, who was the folk singer in the movement in Nashville. And we sang this song, They Go Wild, Simply Wild Over Me. So let's give him a welcome too. I'm a South Carolinian.
All right.
One night in New York, I went to Carnegie Hall. And I was there with some friends, Marietta and Dr. George Dockery, whose daughter went to college with me at Fisk University. And after the event, and of course you don't know who Wilford School for Boys is, that was Eleanor Roosevelt's Wilwood School for Boys, and they trained Floyd Patterson as a young boy, because he was juvenile delinquent. And they, quote, made something out of him, okay? And so we were at the fundraiser, and so they said, oh, don't go home after the fundraiser. You know, come along with us, we're gonna go to some other friend's house. And so I tagged along, and we got to those other friends' house, and they turned out to be Joe and Carol Liebman, who owned Tiffany's. You know Tiffany's, the diamonds? Okay. And there were about six other people there. So Marietta, and I love to say this, you know, is a wonderful person, and she loves to cook, and she loves to entertain. So naturally, she and Carol went right away to the refrigerator, and they began to take out the foods to serve their guests. And of course they gave me a big old tray of hamburgers, and I took them out on the terrace and began to do my favorite thing on the grill, which is to cook out. Well, I wasn't out there maybe 20 minutes, and a young man came out and he said, why didn't you tell us you were a singer? And I said, who are you? He said, I'm the new talent coordinator for the Tonight Show. And I said, well, I auditioned three times for Sylvia Panicotti, and she said she was gonna call me, but she never did. He says, well, we'll have to look into that. He says, maybe you'll have to re-audition. And to make a long story short, within 2 weeks' time, I was making my debut on NBC's Tonight Show with Johnny Carson. So I'm a little girl with a big old voice at that time. And I went on the show and I sang my heart out with, you're gonna hear from me. And that's a song that was written by Murray Grant. And if most people don't know who he is, that was the person that wrote Nancy Wilson's Guess Who I Saw Today, that same composer. When I finished my song, I went and I sat down on the piano. So Johnny said, oh, you seem a little nervous. Oh, yes, yes, I'm kind of nervous. He says, you look like you're glad it's over with. Oh, yes, glad it's over with. He says, I heard you spent a lot of time in jail. He says, How many days did you spend in jail? Oh, I spent about 76 days in jail. He says, but you barely out of college. You're so young and spent so many days in jail. How did you do that? How did you get involved in all of that? And I said, well, my father is a Baptist minister, and I was brought up in church, and I went to Fisk University, and while we were there, we started going to these nonviolent workshops, and in the nonviolent workshops, we would role play, and we would practice so that we could go down and test ourselves at the lunch counters, and then get the reactions and come back and again role play and give our honest reactions to it and thereby develop discipline before we went on the sit-ins. So he said, well, you know, that all is very hard for me because I can't possibly understand that. I said, well, you know, the role playing is just like acting. And I said, and that's when I decided I wanted to be in show business. He says, well, what happened? Did an agent call you up, say, Angela, I got a sit-in for you this evening? I'm a South Carolinian. I grew up in the farm, in a farm, picking cotton, pulling fodder, dry corn, sowing soda to make the plants grow. And I could pick about 25 to 125 pounds of cotton as I grew older. My sister is sitting over there and she can attest to it because she was picking cotton too. So we grew up feeding the dogs, the chickens, the puppies, and we fished in the streams and the countryside. We picked the berries, the blackberries, the gooseberries, and plums on the trees up and down the country road. Sometimes we walked 7 miles to the school in East Dover, South Carolina. Now my mother and father, they were teachers. My father was a minister, a preacher, teacher, and a farmer. He was a mathematical genius as far as I was concerned. He was a wonderful math teacher. And my father was a wonderful farmer, and he really enjoyed going out among the land. And his idol was Booker T. Washington at Tuskegee. Because Booker T. Washington always said, if a black man was a preacher, teacher, and a farmer, and he owned his own land, and he could grow his own crops, he was an independent man. So my father walked across his 68 acres at that point with great pride, knowing that he had purchased those 68 acres for just $3,000 back in the early 40s. That was a time when teachers were paid very little money. And in South Carolina, unequal pay scales. White teachers maybe got up to, you know, $9,000, and black teachers, you know, half of that, if that. So they did all of this on very little money. And that makes me think about us today who make so much money compared to what they make, and we can't do anything with the money that we've got. So 1954 comes, things change. Brown versus the Board of Education. My mother, Miss Emma Butler, is teaching in that school, Crossroad Elementary School. And at that time, you know, everyone is nervous because they don't know what's gonna happen in the South. The White Citizens Council is running. You know, they're intimidating people. The KKK is burning crosses. You know, they're lynching people. And really, in the 50s, it was still as high as like 9,000 people per year throughout the country were being lynched in this country. And they weren't just black people. There were also white people who were working to try to make things better, or took an interest in Black people, because we know we never could do anything by ourselves, okay? I want you to know that even in Harriet Tubman's days, she had to have help, and her help was not necessarily Black help. She had help from white people who sympathized with the Underground Railroad. So I think it's a very important point, historically. So my father being the principal of an elementary school and my mother teaching there, they could not openly admit support for the NAACP, so they couldn't invite them to the school because the states had targeted the NAACP for all state and city workers. But they can invite them to the church. So it was a kind of independence. So you can invite them to the church to speak to the community, but couldn't invite them to the school or to the parent teachers association or to the parent teacher meetings. And so my father, you know, respected that and he kept his job, but they were over at the church talking to the people and trying to get people involved with voter registration. So this is something that was a very big hardship on Black people, because now, because the Brown versus Board of Education decision, you know, your life is unstable, and anybody that they think or hear about that's trying to do anything about change is under a direct threat.
Started out a case like any other, in a little country courthouse long ago. We've been inside 100, Thurgood Marshall wondered how long it would take to end Jim Crow. But this was Brown versus the Board of Education. It was 1954 when they outlawed segregation. Public education said separate wasn't equal anymore, and they wore nine black robes. That's your part. Nine black robes. That's the number. The color and the shape of hope. Nine black robes. Then Clarence Earl Gideon blew his trumpet. And the year was 1963. Tried and imprisoned for the crime of petty theft. He rode to Washington, D.C. with a pencil and a piece of prison paper. Gideon dropped a bombshell in the mail. Said, even though I'm poor, I should have had a lawyer. And the Supreme Court heard his appeal. Everything he wrote tonight, black robes. Sing it again now. Nine black robes. That's the number and the color and the shape of hope. Nine black robes. Then Roe versus Wade, a poor woman. 1973, arrested for an abortion. She took the state to court and they recognized her right of privacy. If you're rich, you can hire the best lawyer in the world. If you're rich, you can send your kids to private schools to learn. If you're rich, you can fly to Sweden for an abortion. But if you're poor, there's nowhere else to turn. You turn to nine black rows. That's the number and the color and the shape of hope. Nine black rows. So who's going to fill Justice Thurgood Marshall's shoes? Who'll stand between the lynch mob and the rights of the accused? Or a back alley abortion and a woman's right to choose? Liberty's a precious thing to lose. It takes nine black rows. Last time, nine black rows. That's the number and the color and the shape of hope. Nine black rows.
That's Mr. Alderman's own song.
Thank you very much.
Rosa Parks was the secretary of the NAACP in Montgomery. Evie Nixon was the president. And they've been working with Septima Clark in the citizenship programs, and so they decided to go with a Highlander for a retreat that they were having. And in that retreat, Septima was the leader of the workshops. And there were many, many people there who had been somehow a part of the program. And so Septima found it with Rosa. And Rosa felt she liked Septima so much that she would like very much to write a book about Septima Poinsett Clark. And it was her easy style, her very gentle manner, her great listening ability to all other people, and her firm and very confident stand when she was trying to get a job done. And so Septima related a story to Rosa Parks about one summer when she went to Atlanta University to study interpersonal relationships with W.E.B. Du Bois. And she used to get on the trolley car, going back and forth to school, and she'd always have to sit in the back of that trolley car. And this one morning, after she had taken her seat in the back of that trolley car on her way to school, a mother came on with a little boy who was barely 6 years old, and Septima said she could see from where she was sitting in the back down the aisle, and how joyous the little boy was to get on that trolley car. So he took the first seat available right behind the bus driver. His mama said, "You who can't sit up there, come on back here with me. Come on, you got to move, you can't sit there." And the little boy said, "Oh no, mama. I'm mama's little man. I can sit up to the front." Septima said when she arrived at school, she told Dr. W.B. Du Bois the story. And he looked at her for a very long time and he said, "There will come a time when black people will do what's necessary to change that thing." 4 years later, we are students and at Fisk University. And we're going to workshops, we're testing, we're doing all of that. So we're going to the few songs on Friday nights, and they're Quakers. There were faculty members at Fisk, conscientious objectors to war, pacifists. Students were looking for new directions. And so they went to the few songs, and we cooked together, we ate together, and then we talked together. And there were black students there and exchange students who were mainly white students from other colleges like Pomona, like DePaul University, who had come to Fisk for just a semester. And when I looked around at the black and white faces, something that we would never see where I had come from, I remember how comfortable we all felt with each other. And so we would begin to tell stories about the places that we came from. We would begin to talk about race relations, inclusion, creating opportunities for our future. Racism, the KKK, violence. And students were hungry. They were hungry because they wanted a new life. They wanted to be able to graduate from a place like Tennessee State University or American Baptist Theological Seminary or Meharry Medical College or Fisk University and have a better opportunity than their parents had had. Many of the students from Tennessee A&I, their parents were simple farm workers, and they scraped and saved for their children to go to school. It was a hardship. Teachers made a little more money, but not a lot of money. My parents sent four girls to Fisk University. For some people, that may not seem like a lot, but the tuition at Fisk University was $700 a year. Okay? And it began to raise even higher. So, Septima, again, was giving us direction about the need to educate our children. Rosa Parks, 4 weeks later, after she was at Highlander School with Septima, went back to Montgomery. And that is when she decided not to give up her seat on that bus. And in the words of Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King, he speaks of Rosa Parks on the 1st of December. Fine, disciplined, and dignified. She says, "My cup of endurance runneth over, and I can take it no longer." Martin Luther, in the 16th century, over the sale of indulgences to the Catholic Church, was charged with heresy. He says, "I will not recant. So help me God." Rosa Parks, on the 1st of December, sitting down on the back of that bus, she says, "I can take it no longer, so help me God." And when that bus driver came up to her and he said, "Woman, you better get up, give me that seat. I'll have you arrested." Rosa Parks looked at him with great humility and said, "You may do that." Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saves a wretch like me. But now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to feel, and grace my fears relieved. How precious, dear, that grace appeared. The hour of this belief. Many dangers, toils, and snares I have already gone. 'Twas grace that brought my heart safely home, and grace will lead me home.
Sons took the students back over to Highlander for a retreat. And at this retreat, Septima Clark was conducting a workshop on the citizenship schools. I'm so happy to see all of you and how many of you have come today, different parts of the South. There's Esau Jenkins, Bernice Robinson, Ella Baker from North Carolina, and she's doing a great job over there with the NAACP. I want to thank you, Ella, for all the work you've given us on the citizenship schools, helping us to organize in North Carolina. Rosa, why are you sitting so far in the back? Come on up to the front. And then there's a young person visiting us from New York, Andrew Young. He's come down to help us out and to get involved with the movement. And we hope that we can make his stay pleasant, and he wants to work with us here in Highlander, our education programs. And then there's the few sons. And I see they brought quite a few students with them from Nashville. Now, the citizenship program, nowadays we have about 2,000 teachers in about 9 southern states. And that's been going on for a while. We're even getting funding now from the Highlander and also from the Marshall Field Foundation, and they're in Chicago. They wrote us a $400,000 grant this year, and we can now pay our teachers about $25 a month. Oh, you have a question? Yes. well, we started in 1954 in Charleston, South Carolina. In fact, Esau Jenkins and myself organized the first school, and Miss Bernice Robinson was our first teacher, and she is a beautician. We had 14 students in the first school, and we could only do it in January and February because it was cabbage picking season in March, and so whatever we were going to teach anyone, we had to do it in those 2 months. And so 8 of our trainees were able to go out and register to vote. Oh, you want to know how we taught the people? Well, we had to start, first of all, teaching people to write their own names. And a lot of times, you know, we were teaching in beauty parlors, barber shops, back porches, and in living rooms, because we couldn't let white people know that we were training black people to read and write and to go down and register and vote. So the groups were always small. But that first group in Charleston showed us that we were going to be successful at this. Oh, you want to know? Okay. How did we teach them reading? Okay. Well, we used brown paper bags. We pin them against the wall of someone's house, tack them up. And then we used a crayon, the white crayon or the, you know, colored crayon. And sometimes we use the words from hymns that people already knew. And we would write down the word or phrase, and we'd have them to repeat it by rote. And we had already taught them the alphabet, so they got to know the lettering in it. And now they would write down the phrase. And then sometimes we used passages from the Bible, because that's something that all of the people knew too, like the Lord is my shepherd or whatever, I shall not want. Okay, then we would also use bank slips, because for people who had bank accounts, we needed to teach them how to write checks. Now, this seems very primary to a lot of people out here today, doesn't it? Doesn't that seem very primary? But we had a population, you know, that grew up after slavery that was totally illiterate. They were probably better at counting numbers than they were at reading and writing. And so in addition to, you know, the words and phrases, we finally got people to the point where they had enough vocabulary that they would be able to write a small story about their life and their work. And then we knew they were good enough to go down and register and vote. And we would provide transportation and everything for them. And also, we put a couple other people on the bus to try to provide safety. So, today, we have registered over 200,000 voters. And our goal is 1 million voters. And what we want to do
The people that are teaching right now have to have like a 6th to an 8th grade reading level. We're not looking for, you know, people who are in the school systems and stuff, because they would lose their jobs if they're associated with us. You know, we need them to teach our children. But we do need them to run for the school board, to run for the town council, to run for the city council, and to run for the state and state offices, like the Senate and the Congress. And we need that, and we pretty soon are going to have the kinds of numbers that we can put our people in office, and we can have power, control, and influence over our destiny. So the Nashville students went back, and the first thing that they did was they set up a voter registration campaign. And on their weekends, they would go from door to door asking people if they were registered, and if they weren't registered, you know, try to set it up through the Clark Memorial Church that they'd be able to go downtown and register. So we have nonviolent workshops, we have registration campaigns, and we have test demonstrations. It is the time of February, the spring of 1960. 4 students sat in at lunch counters in Greensboro. They received national attention. The next day they went back, they closed the store on them, they didn't get arrested. The next day they went back and they took 25 of their friends and they sat in at the counters in North Greensboro. They closed the store on them, they didn't do anything. And then all of a sudden they disappeared and they didn't do anything else. So Nashville heard about it and decided, no, this mustn't die out like that. And so we put 500 students sitting in every place they could. February 13th. And they closed the stores on us. On February 20th, we put 350 students from all 4 colleges. We sat there all day long, and they closed the stores on us, never threatening us with arrest. There were many hecklers, but the store didn't threaten us with arrest. We were sitting in places like Kane Sloan's, we were sitting in Harvey's department store, the Walgreens, the McClellan's Five and Dime, Woolworth, Cresses, that was very popular at that time, and any place that we could find a count, including Greyhound, Trailway, we went to those places in small groups. Now February 27th comes. Kelly Noah Smith, pastor of the First Baptist Church, where we had most of our meetings, received that message early in the morning. It was the chief of police. Tell those students, if they come downtown this morning, they will be arrested. This was very difficult for us because we hadn't really talked about going to jail, even though we've been testing since 59. But this was reality on this morning. So our central committee, which were 13 people, spent a couple of hours downstairs in the basement of Kelly Miller Smith's church. And we could not come to consensus on this because we're worried about appearance. We're worried about what would happen if we were in jail. Let's say KKK could call and say, Mr. Bimble, your son is up in Nashville acting up. And if you don't get your son under control, we're going to burn your house down in Mississippi. That's how bad it was. It was a simple phone call from the white KKK, from the White Citizens Council. So this was a lot to think about because we also didn't know, even though Nashville is the Athens of the South, what would happen to us once we were in jail, if we'd be taken out in the night and beaten. We didn't know what would happen. That man that we were dealing with is very unpredictable. So we couldn't come to a consensus. For the first time in almost a year being together, we had to take a vote. And this morning, it was 7-4, 5 against, and 1 abstention. And we took that vote upstairs. And where there had been 500 students 2 weeks before and 350 the week before on the Saturday, there were only 44 students upstairs. And when we told them about the risk, and that they might be expelled from school, one by one, they raised their hands. Go downtown and go to jail.
Service. I'd like a hot dog, please. Waiter, service, please. I'd like a hamburger and a milkshake. You gotta call the manager?
What's the problem over here? You know you're not supposed to be here, man.
Service. Waitress, service, please.
No, you're not going to get served.
I'd like tuna fish and a Coca-Cola.
Well, we're going to have to call the manager to get your neighbors out of here. You know you're not supposed to be here now. You're not going to get served today.
Service, please.
Hold on, man.
We have a right to be served here. We,
no,
we spend our money. We spend our money. We shopped in the store, we buy goods here, and now we'd like to be served at the counter.
What brands are you talking?
Hamburger, please.
You ain't gonna get no hamburger, you know that. Now you take your friends,
waitress,
get on back to your side.
Let me speak to you, man.
Can you let us get on with our business here?
Now, waitress!
Manager, we gotta get some help over here. We got a lot of uppity niggers around here.
Service, please.
Get served, and we gotta get back to business
here. Service. Service, please. We can see the long mirror. Crowds were gathering around. And they dragged one of our exchange students, who was white, off the counter. And they began to beat him. And they 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 beat him down to the floor. The police came. They said, you're all under arrest. And they took Paul and the two hecklers and led them to jail. We were outside. And we thought we had been arrested. But they only arrested Paul and the two hecklers. So I pulled my group back inside and said, let's get back inside. They had roped off the counter, so we stepped over the ropes and sat down again. Service, please. We'd like a hamburger and like a Coca-Cola. The police came in and said, you're all under arrest.
Incidents that spread to some 68 cities across the South. Students were expelled in Louisiana by the hundreds. They were expelled in Tallahassee, Florida. And in Nashville, we had 19 students that were expelled from Tennessee A&I University. The next year, we got involved deeper with voter registration because we had the Kennedy election coming up and all the students went out like they did for Barack Obama. And they really, really campaigned in the country, except we didn't have a Starbucks then that we could go to. And so, you know, John Kennedy, you know, won that election. And we have, I believe, students give credit for that 1960-61 voter registration drive. And, you know, it goes back to Septimine, Roseanne, Ellen, Edie Nixon, and Esau Jenkins. Those were the foundations. And so here we are in 1961 with the Freedom Rides. And of course, you've seen probably the recent documentary on the Freedom Rides, and you know of the terrible violence that occurred, you know, on the first bus that came from Washington, D.C., where they firebombed the bus in Anniston, Alabama. And we had two students on that bus, John Lewis and Hank Thomas, because CORE had asked us to send representatives, so we sent Hank Thomas from Howard and John Lewis from Fisk. And then, you know, our students you know, they flew those first passengers on that bus because of the violence. They flew them over to New Orleans, and people thought that the riots would stop. Nashville, again, picked up the banner, and we sent 19 students on two different buses. We sent them to Birmingham. And Bull Connor arrested our students and put them in the drunk tank. And then in the middle of the night, drove them back to the state line of Alabama and told me, get out of town and not ever come back to the state of Alabama. Well, we sent Kwame Little and a few other people down to pick them up in the car. And I was a coordinator at that point. I was on the Central Committee, so all of us are coordinators. Okay, we're equal, we're not one person doing anything, we're just rotating. And so we sent several cars to pick them up, and they refused to come back. They decided they wanted to continue the rides, and so they went back into Birmingham. And now they took the bus from Birmingham to Montgomery. In the meantime, we called Martin Luther King because the violence was so pronounced in Birmingham and on the Edison, Alabama bus that we wanted to make sure that there was maybe some kind of protection. So Martin Luther King called Governor Patterson, and he tried to get them to give some protection for the bus. He got no response at all. So then he called the federal government, and through Bobby Kennedy and John Kennedy, who was running the presidential nomination and presidential election at that time, we were able to get a commitment for some minor protection. They sent a federal government agent, Seligman, to Montgomery. And he was negotiating with Governor Patterson to try to get Governor Patterson to give a helicopter, some state patrolmen to ride along with the bus, and also to get some policemen on motorcycles. And it looked like the bus from Birmingham had a proper escort. But all of a sudden, when they got to Montgomery, the helicopter disappeared. The state patrolman disappeared, and there was just a bus with one lonely motorcycle cop going into Montgomery. There were about 20 press people on the, where the bus arrives, the waiting area. But in front of the bus terminal, there were over 200 people mobbed with sticks, baseball bats, anything they could put their hands on, sticks. And when the Freedom Riders deboarded the bus, they gouged at their eyes. They beat them with sticks. They beat them and beat them. William Harbin, you should see today the scars that he has on this part of his body from that 1961 beating. John Lewis almost had a permanent concussion. Jim Swerg was so battered, he was a white exchange student from Fisk. He was so battered that they hospitalized him, and his parents flew in the night to come get him and take him to another hospital. I mean, he literally, you know, he probably would have died if they hadn't done that. And then Seligman, the federal representative, they beat him too. The white people beat him too. These people in Alabama were so terrible. And Medgar Evers called, and he said they shouldn't continue to ride because if they got that kind of beating in Alabama, they're sure to be killed in Mississippi. Our students from Nashville survived that beating and they were staying at Dr. Harris's house. Martin Luther King flew in there to see about them, and he wanted to go on the ride. But the people around him felt it was better for him to stay on the outside and continue talking to the federal government to try to continue to get some kind of protection. Meantime, the governor of Mississippi decided that he wasn't going to tolerate that kind of violence in his state. So as they crossed the state line in Mississippi, and I want you to know that Matthew Walker, Catherine Burke, I can't call all of their names right now, but they signed their last will and testament before going into Jackson, Mississippi. So the governor had them arrested as soon as they crossed the state line, and he took them right to the Jackson jail. And then, in the middle of the night, he came with a big old bus, and then he took them to the Parchman Penitentiary. Cell block 17, death row. Pauline Knight and Catherine Burke were just across the hallway from the gas chamber. There was no light. I've recently been to Mississippi and I've seen those cells. They were tiny little cells that had only a little bunk cot, a stool, and a basin, and no light. To put the guys on the chain gang, they made the women work in the kitchens and do work around the prison. And when they left Parchman Penitentiary, they took the bus into Macomb, Mississippi. And Macomb, they took the women out of the cells, beat them, and then put them back in the cells. We changed that law. That law was on the books already through Boynton versus the state of Virginia, 1960, that we had a right to not be discriminated against in interstate travel. There were thousands of freedom riders. Arsenault's book accounts for 400, but there were thousands of freedom riders. It came from everywhere. It was 500 Anderson and had Lon King on it, had Virginia Brown on it from my hometown. So he's writing about stuff 40 years later, and you can't find the informants. It's where the problem is. No book ever tells the full story. A freedom rider is a freedom fighter, not necessarily someone who just went on the bus. I'd like to close by saying that we were involved in so many different things between 1959 and 68. It was impossible to cover everything in an hour, but I'll give you the sequence. We had Mississippi summer in 1964, and that's when Stroman, Goodman, and Cheney were killed. Three young people, two white and one black. All they wanted to do was to get people to register and vote. And if they had to teach literacy, they would. And this is why voting is so important today, because people lost their lives trying to get that privilege for us to vote. '65, we have Selma, Bloody Sunday, three different marches. One person lost his life, on the first march. Another person lost his life on the second march. Martin Luther King went on the third march. And that's when the state troopers and everyone met him, and they knelt down and prayed. And then after that, they did the march from Selma to Montgomery, where they had thousands of troopers, state troopers, and everyone protecting them. That's like a fourth march. 65, 66, 67, 68, Memphis, garbage worker strike. Again, Nashville in the leadership, Jim Lawson with the nonviolent workshops, James Bevel from our committee, there in leadership in Memphis, 67 and 68. King goes there unannounced to see how the committee is doing. And things are very hard in Memphis at that point because a young man had been killed about a month before that, a 16-year-old, I believe. And also, they had expected Martin to show up at the march, 22nd march, and he couldn't get there because of the snow. And I think 20,000 young people from high school had taken their day off to go on that march. And so there's a lot of controversy and disappointment, this kind of thing. We also have, during that period, the rise of Black power leadership within the ranks of SNCC. And that's changing the impetus, and they're moving away from, quote, nonviolence. They're moving into culturalism, Black culturalism. Then we have the Panthers on the West Coast who are saying that they won't practice nonviolence at all, that they will guard their communities, and that they will protect the communities. Gentleman here is a Black Panther. Would you say? This is Mr. Hank Jones. You may know him through the recent case of the San Francisco 8. He was a student of the coordinating committee member first, which is my organization. And Mary Berry was our first chairperson, who six times was the city councilman in Washington, D.C. How many people know Mary Berry? You see what great things came out of just people on the Central Committee? And Mary Berry. Okay, and Mary Berry, James Bevel had a lot to do with the training of Barack Obama. You better believe me. James Bevel ran for election in Chicago in 1976 for Congress in Chicago. He was the first Black man to do that. And he had 30% of the vote. Isn't that amazing? Just dealing with the little precincts and stuff that he was organizing. 30% of the vote. So naturally, a person like Barack Obama would study a person's work like James Bevel. And we mustn't forget the March on Washington, because that was James Bevel's idea. James Bevel wanted, it's not Brian Rustin's idea, as they tell us on the television. See, there's a lot of myths. They say because Brian wrote, you know, the book on all the rules and regulations and how they're going to behave and what they want to accomplish and everything, that somehow he did all the planning. No, no. Okay? Nobody ever does that by themselves. That's a group activity, okay? There's other people making input, okay? You know, he might get the credit, the final credit. But James Bevel, the young minister from Mississippi, on our committee, Nashville Central Committee, a freedom rider, an organizer of the Selma marches, an organizer of Mississippi, an organizer of garbage worker strike, suggested to Martin Luther King in the early 60s that there should be a march on Washington, but it should be 150,000 people walking from Montgomery to Washington, D.C. Now, the reason they didn't do it that way was because Martin Luther King thought he couldn't, where would people sleep? Where would people rest? You know, where would they go to the toilet? You know, what if someone got sick? You know, it was just too big of a commitment. But this was James Bevel's idea. And Andy Young documents that in his autobiography. So these students had a lot to do with this change that has come about in that period of 59 to 68. And we acknowledge everything that Rosa Parks and Septima Poinsett Clark did, because SNCC adopted citizenship programs. And they took them into Mississippi and they got these people to register and vote. And they provided whatever needs they needed. And with that, I would like to close with a poem that James Bevel wrote on the day that Martin Luther King was killed. Oh, he carried the cross for me. He carried the cross for me. When I was just a boy playing with a toy, he was concerned about my liberty. When I stood telling tales, he spent many days in jail to restore my humanity. We were dying in Vietnam, and he stopped old Uncle Sam and made him respect all humanity. He never was afraid, because this is what he said: "My son, you must learn to forgive. If you haven't got anything to die for, you ain't fit to live." Oh, he carried the cross for me. The day that Martin Luther King died, I sat down and cried. He carried the cross for me. Way up high, I'm on the tempo. There's a man that I heard of once in a lullaby. Somewhere that we dare to dream really do come true. Someday I wish upon a star and wake up where the skies are far behind me, where troubles melt like lemon drops away above the chimney tops. That's where can't If happy little bluebirds fly, beyond the rainbow, why, oh, why can't
Angeline Butler, ladies and gentlemen, the one and only.
What a powerful, powerful message. Presentation, wonderful. Ms. Butler is going to now take some questions from the audience. You guys have some questions you want to ask?
You said, did everything stop? No. They didn't stop. It's just for a time, SNCC eventually kind of went its own direction. People kind of moved on. Things changed. Okay, we were now into a more militant phase. We were beginning to hear more from Malcolm X. Malcolm X and Black Muslims, people in the North were beginning to be a little bit more disillusioned with nonviolence and because of the assassinations, you know, there've been so many of them. And so there was a lot of disillusionment, and so for a time, SNCC sort of died out, okay? But then you saw the rise of people during elections. Now all of a sudden people began to run for offices. And now we had all of these elected officials, what is the? I wonder what's going on. People began to run, you know, they used the ballot. And we had now all of a sudden, you know, a very strong black, what is a counterpart, you know, running for offices in all the southern states. Getting into the Senate, getting into the city councils, getting into, and a lot of people were people from the civil rights movement. And even in this generation right now, one thing that they say, they kind of joke about it, but they talk about all the civil rights people at that time and how their sons and daughters now are in the state senates and legislatures and stuff. Now, I just went down to Mississippi and they had 23 people in the state senate and the legislature, you know, and we were able to meet all of those people because we had a breakfast one morning at, believe it or not, Haley Baldwin's mansion. And we told them on that day what we think, what we thought, you know, that he really needed to create more industry. He needed to bring more jobs to the, you know, and we felt that while he could brag and say he had a mayor, you know, that he had a chief of police that was black, and he had a head of the prison that was black, you know. And we saw it in Parchment. We saw this black man that was standing there that was heavy. He wanted to know how much we enjoyed the food and stuff they served us at Parchment and stuff. But I said to black guys, I said, you know, when we were here earlier, it was white folks putting y'all in jail, but now it's black folks putting y'all in jail. Okay, so, you know, sometimes, even though they change the faces, you know, somehow policies don't change that much. And so we become disillusioned on that, and we think now, well, why vote and put these people in when they don't really do anything? No, people, we feel our way. We feel our way, don't we feel our way? You know, they ride around in big cars, and they got these big budgets, and they got this, now I'm really serious, you know? And so I'm always proud when I meet a Maxine Waters, you know, or Sheila Jackson Lee. You know, I'm always proud when I see somebody, you know, like the lady who's secretary of labor. What's her name? Yeah, Ms. Solis. I think she's very good. You know, and that's great that she's there, but she's really doing a great job. You know what I mean?
You know Corinne Brown?
I know the name.
She's like a Maxine Waters in Florida. You would say she's like a Maxine Waters type. That's a Maxine Waters.
Yeah, but Diane Watson was pretty good too. You know, and I was in California at that time teaching at the University of Southern California. And we founded a Martin Luther King Museum over at Prince Hill High School, 7 points at Park, without me living at that point. And my friend from Fisk, whose name I can't call right now, was teaching. And she invited us, said, Yvonne, and Septon Clark and I were the support for founding that little Martin Luther King Museum at Prince Hill High School. Okay, so, you know, people have been doing stuff all the time, you know. I think people have to do what they can where they are. You don't always have to belong to an organization, you know, because I get an awful lot done by being independent. But you have to be conscious, and you have to want to do something, you know, because I moved into academia, and I changed a lot of programs, and I brought a lot of programs. Like, for instance, Cal State Northridge University, I revived Lorraine Hansberry's Lake Love. You remember that? That was my project. And that spoke of apartheid and racism, okay? And I was the only person in the West Coast who ever did that, you know. But, you know, all of us have been doing different things. So, did the movement die? No. It's just as a group under the heading of SNCC, you know, we were no more. But each one of us carried that cross. I mean, Matt Jones always told me, he says, you know, it's like once you've been doing this work, it's like it's something you can't get out of your system. It follows you around every place you go. And you hate yourself sometimes because you say, my goodness, why can't I see that and not do something about it? You know what I mean? You know, why can't I just sit by like everybody else and not do anything? You know, you know, I go into universities and stuff, and I see in the curriculum they don't have certain things, and I'm an ethnomusicologist. So, like Cal State Dominguez Hills, I designed a program for them, ethno arts, you know, which went around the world with cultural things because they didn't have it. At USC, when I was professor there, most of you don't even know I was a professor at USC, but I was. You know, I've lived a long time now, and I'm 70 years old. I'm 70. And I still practice martial arts. I'm in Canada, and I do it twice a week. Sometimes I can't go because of all the old legs. And then I go the next week, you know, it's that way. And we swim, and we try to keep our health. Because it's very important to keep your health. Because if you don't have good health, you can't do anything for anybody anyway, right? So I think also that's a living testament to people in the 60s. I think my generation grew up healthier, using less drugs, and I think we've survived in better state. I mean, I look at Diane Nash, she's about the same as me. We look about the same as we did when we were in college, got a big stomach or whatever. But you know, we have the same energy. You know, I look at John Lewis, we have the same energy. I look at, I mean, a few of us have died. There have been a few tragedies because the movement didn't prepare us to deal with the anger we had inside of ourselves, you know, holding back. You know, it isn't that we didn't have anger. You know, we didn't just love Uncle Charlie, okay? You know what I mean? But we had to exercise a discipline. That's like being in the military. You know, there's a code of behavior. So we followed that, but no one prepared us for the aftermath. You know, the anger that we couldn't unleash at the time. You don't think we really enjoyed being in jail. You don't think Pauline and Catherine Burke enjoyed being in Parchment Prison and gas chambers there and have to think that maybe they will be next. You know, I mean, this is a devastating thing. It's like Catherine Burke says today, I'll take anything to do. You know what I mean? Because it's still with her, you know what I mean? And she was in tears when I was with her in the spring while we're in Parchment, you know, and I said, I don't believe it. I said, and I'm so glad I'm here today to witness this because Hank took us back to Parchment. It was very important for us to do that.
Any other questions? Yes.
Just something. When I was about 13, I heard this.
The student nonviolent coordinating committee.
It's us. But nationally before.
When's the last time you've seen a Jorna? His name Jim? The one I read about him recently. The one, his dad was a dentist and he had his teeth knocked out several times. He was, he was one of the freedom riders, when they went, he got beat up really bad.
Right. I haven't been in touch with him.
He's a veteran now.
You know, there were so many freedom riders. You know, which direction did his bus come from? Did it come from New Orleans into Jackson? Did it come from Atlanta into Jackson? Did it go from Nashville? You know, I know everybody was on Nashville, as I said. But I don't know, the people at Rudy Lombard in New Orleans said. I met some of those people in Mississippi at the Freedom Ride conference this past spring. I met some of those wonderful people. And you know, every day that I live, you know, something comes new to me. For instance, I was in Milwaukee in August. Now, think about this. I was taking a train from Milwaukee down to Chicago. Just me. Nobody knew me, right? Lady sat down with me on the train and we started talking. Guess who she was? She was one of the 100 students from Macomb, Mississippi, who had been arrested in high schools when Brenda Travis had been trying to be a freedom rider, and they arrested her. And they arrested 100 high school students in Macomb, put them in jail for 3 months. And they allowed the parents to visit them and stuff, just wouldn't let them out of jail. They didn't really have any charges against them. They just wanted to make sure they weren't in the school what they considered stirring up trouble, right? And so when after 3 months they let them out, they sent all those students to different schools because they didn't want them to congregate again. Now, what's the chances that I'll just ride down on a train, you know, in August of what year is this? 2011. That's a lady like that was sitting down. I tell you something, she taught me a lot because I didn't know about those students. And I learned something every day because it's such a big movement and it took so many people. And that's why I really hate it when they attach things to one person. You know, King was marvelous because when he went among us, he never tried to assume leadership. He would listen, he would be quiet, he'd be very supportive. You ask him to do something, he'd do, you know, but he never tried to take over anybody's stuff, you know what I mean? And nowadays, you know, when people, you know, have meetings and stuff like that, you know, they always got this agenda and there's always this leader and there's always this rigidity. You know, why don't they just talk to each other and find out what people want to do? Why don't they hear the voices of people and their concerns? And now, after you hear that, make a decision on what your direction is. Because if you, Central Park always said, if you listen to people, they will tell you what needs to be done.
Any other questions?
I just want to say thank you for working with your life station. I really felt it today. I also want to ask you, what message do you have for us?
Well, you know, I think that, you know, we had a recent movement with Occupy Wall Street. And while I have a lot of problems with Occupy Wall Street, that was at least one thing that happened recently that brought some attention to the conversation that needs to be held in the country, is rich gets the poor, you know, the corruption of big businesses and helping the economy fall, the fact that we're out of jobs, the fact that we have this homelessness, the fact that, but on the other hand, I don't like the fact that a lot of people in Occupy Wall Street says, we are bringing down America just like they brought down Egypt. You understand? That's not my feeling. I feel this. With all the traveling I've done in the world, I've lived in a lot of different countries. Ireland, France, I've lived in Australia, you know, I've lived in Canada. I still think that this is the greatest country, and I think we need to fight to make this one better. You know what I mean? Because I don't think that we need to allow this corruption, these drugs, and all these things in this country to tear our country apart. And I think we still need to find a way to arrest the big guys instead of the little guys, and you know, and stop giving all these heavy sentences to the ethnic population, when in fact they're not the ones that bring the drugs in the country. Okay?
And even Ron Paul says that. You know, I have to give him that. But this is Occupy Wall Street also has an invisible leadership. And you know, that could have gone a different direction if they had been different people. And that frightens me to death, that young people would just sort of listen to something on the internet and not go out and do it. You know what I mean? Without knowing who it is that is behind the leadership. So I say to the leadership of Occupy Wall Street, you know, take off your mask, come out from behind your computers, let us know who you're talking to. Now we can talk about what needs to be done in the future, because they need to identify themselves. And until they do that in the future, I don't know that I will be participating anymore. I did go on them in New York. I even bought clothing for them in the winters, you know, like I went actually shopping, you know, I spent my hard dollars to get some gloves and mittens and stuff, because they were freezing to death down there, you know. And then I also went on several marches where there were a lot of teachers, a lot of educators on the marches that they were showing sort of where the rich were. And, you know, I want us to demonstrate. You know, I think if King were here, he would say that Occupy Wall Street needs training, because there's been too many needless arrests over things that didn't have to do with the demonstration that they were on. Example, New York. Empty parking lot over there, you know, by where they were thinking. They said, oh, it's empty, we can occupy it. So they sent 20 people over there. They got arrested because they were off the turf of what they had permission to do. And I mean, that's senseless. Then in Brooklyn, instead of doing what they got a permit to do, which was to go where people normally walk and march, they chose to just stop the traffic and go in the street, okay? Now, I don't know that that made their demonstration any more effective. I just know an awful lot of people got an awful lot of jail records that day. And, you know, nobody's taking those jail records off of their records. And we got enough black people with jail records that's keeping us, you know, off the unemployment, keeping us unemployed. You know, we really don't, you know, we have to really be careful in the sense that we have to, when we're going to get arrested, we have to make sure that we decide where that's going to be, not just off the cuff.
Any other questions?
How about that energy, Ms. Butler shows?
And I have a very high success rate in students, you know, because I allow them to argue and fight with them. And they tell me everything that I always give them assignments based on their contemporary issues, the things that they're concerned with, whether it's college, paying tuition. You know, how can they really do that? You know, what's not one of the options? I make them do their own research, and then they read it in class, their reports. And it helps everybody, because a lot of people don't get it from their counselors where they really understand.
Once again, we want to thank you so much for coming out. And Ms. Butler, you really, this has been beautiful. It's wonderful. You have given us a wealth of knowledge and information, and you give it with so much passion.
Hey, thank you. I want to thank Ross Altman. Thank you. My family is here. This is Tiffany Balashange and her daughter, Mayaja. They were spending 10 years in Africa. They just come back in the last year. And they were in Ghana. And this is Miss Virginia Harris, who is a cousin of mine. She is a past social worker here with the Department of Social Services. And this is Miss Mildred Lane Shirley, who is currently in the Los Angeles schools. What's your position? And this is Miss Margaret, Miss Emma Margaret Butler. And she is also a teacher and a consultant. And you're also, what else? She's an MBA from USC. In economics. Okay. These are my sisters. He's a dentist by profession. And they've been very, very kind to me over a period of years and very supportive, and I greatly appreciate it, because we have no more father and mother than God in heaven.
And father died about 7 years ago, and mother died almost 2.5 years ago. And they were Reverend Mrs. Isaac Barton, but one of them still in South Carolina. They were big ones. Well, we very often go because we still own our properties and everything there. And my sister lives on the property that my mother lived on. She has her own property there, but Mary basically is the caretaker in place. Oh, really? Yeah, we love the South, you know. Maybe Frederick, Charlie? He's a raw vegetarian. And he has his own greenhouse, and he's Frederick is graduated from, he's a psychologist, and he graduated from Fisk University. He has his own greenhouse. He sells wheatgrass, and he sells it to marketplaces, and he sells it in the Long Beach market, and he also teaches assistant in the LA schools. Now, Mr. Don Norman over there did our came tonight. He's with the Holy United Methodist Church, and he put us in the bulletin for this. You know, but it's quite a distance away, you know. But Mr. Don Norman has been a friend of mine for quite some time. We greatly appreciate the fact that
you're afraid to say 30 years.
So, but isn't that wonderful that you came and videotaped us? We have. Diane, I want to thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
You know, it was really a privilege. You know, I worked very hard on preparing this because on Martin Luther King Day, I believe it or not, you ever heard of St. Peter's Lutheran Church in New York? The very famous Bad Jazz Church. The pastor turned the church over to me for 3 services. Oh. And now my sisters in South Carolina say, oh, well, you know, there was Dolores Butler, the other sister in Maryland. Her husband got a PhD in theology. Now he's preaching. No, there's Reverend Angeline Butler. I said, no, I'm not preaching. But thank you so much. And thanks to the staff here for the help that you gave us. The gentleman got it.
Jennifer.
Is that Antonio?
Yes.
Antonio, and also Mrs. Lorraine. Okay. Thank you.